Good evening, everyone. This is a very strange experience for one who's never done this kind of thing before. Talking to myself on the computer. I hope somebody's listening. Right. I have a very long list of extremely interesting and challenging questions. So, let us begin, shall we? I begin with a couple of questions. One from Claudia Ginares dos Santos, and a very similar one from Greece, from Nikos Stragiadakis. The obvious question that they asked is there light at the end of the tunnel? Is there any future for our kids? Now, we make a major distinction between optimism and hope. A point being that if we look scientifically at all the evidence, there seems very little evidence that good things are going to happen. But the fundamental difference, I keep saying this, repeating it again and again until I'm blue in the face, the fundamental difference between a physicist and political activists like us here at DiEM25 is that a physicist, a natural scientist, doesn't have to worry about the impact that his or her predictions, his or her theories, his or her prognostication is going to have on nature. A meteorologist predicts the weather, and the weather is going to be whatever it's going to be, independently of what the meteorologist predicts. But we, citizens of Europe, of Greece, of Germany, of Britain, of the world, we create our history. The social phenomena that we're trying to predict, the question, is there going to be light at the end of the tunnel, depends on what we do. Therefore, we have a moral and political duty to our children, Niko Fragiadaki, not to ask these questions, not to ask, is there light at the end of the tunnel? We have a duty to create the light at the end of the tunnel and to take all of us collectively towards it. But let me be a bit more, optimistic, why not? Of course, there is light at the end of the tunnel. We are going to have to create it. It's not going to happen because, yeah, it happens. But it really is very simple. All we need is a grand coalition of Europeans that are going to say enough and who will change stuff. Now, of course, this is easier said than done, but it is up to us. And this is why we're here, G25. This is why we're not doing something else tonight, like, you know, watching something silly on the Idiot Box or reading a poem. We're here because we feel, firstly, the responsibility, and secondly, the possibility of genuine change. Now, there are many worries in our own heads, even though we have coalesced around GM25 on the basis of a common set of principles. But nevertheless, there are lingering concerns that we all have. Here is one by Alberto Huerta, who is asking a pertinent question. Is it possible, Alberto is asking, to create solidarity on the basis of class consciousness between peoples in countries that are suffering Great Depression, like Greece, Portugal, countries where there is a permanent depression, like in the Baltic countries, Latvia and in Lithuania, where the vast majority have to live on a pittance without any serious welfare state, very low pensions and benefits. Is there any way that these people, whether they're Latvians or Greeks or Portuguese, can come together on the basis of class consciousness with, let's say, Germans or Dutch, who are much, much richer? Well, allow me to say that this is why Diem was put together. The powers that be, the establishment, the deep establishment, as I like to call it, in Europe, is very keen to convince us that the problem in Europe is that we're too different, that divisions along the north-south divide, or the east-west divide these days, are very difficult to overcome. And that we better keep ourselves to ourselves, the Germans having their own debt, their own banking system, their own welfare system, the Greeks or the Latvians have their own, and the only thing that joins us together is, you know, some confederate institutions, the euro, the European Central Bank. At the same time, they like to blame the euro crisis and the European crisis on what I call the grasshoppers of the south and of the east, the riffraff that live in the periphery. There is this quaint theory that there are the hardworking Germans and the Mediterraneans who are sponging off the settlers' countries. In reality, what we have is a situation where for many years, for far too long, there's been an unholy alliance between the scroungers of the north and the scroungers of the south, the grasshoppers of the north and the grasshoppers of the south, in Greek, tzatzikia of the north and tzatzikia of the south. The bankers of Frankfurt, the bankers of Athens, of Madrid, of Italy, have always had a fantastic alliance amongst themselves. They produce absolutely nothing. They just push paper and they used to make billions. They created false values. And they lived a remarkable period, existence of plenty. The cacophony of money making was astonishing. Meanwhile, the ants, the hardworking ants of the south and of the north, were busily struggling to make ends meet, even during the good times. And when the whole thing exploded, when all these huge amounts of debt that the grasshoppers of the north and the grasshoppers of the south created, when those debts erupted, the grasshoppers of the north and of the south turned around and blamed the ants of the north and the ants of the south. So the working class of Spain, of Portugal, of Greece, of Germany, always fell behind during the good times and were lumped all the costs of the crisis that the grasshoppers, the bankers, and the oligarchs created amongst themselves in that unholy alliance of North, South, East, and West. Unless we manage to create that class consciousness that allows German workers and Latvian workers and Greek workers and Portuguese workers and British workers to realize that we have a common interest, they have a common interest in creating a transnational opposition to the unholy alliance of the grasshoppers, then we're then always going to be in trouble. Petros Konstantinidis is asking a similar question. He says, well, given all the disparities, given the undemocratic nature of the European Union, would it not be better if we went back to the nation state? We had a multi-speed Europe, a variable geometry with more sovereignty at the level of the nation state, where we can, at the level of the nation state, the Greeks, the Italians, the Spaniards, the Brits, separately, with some cooperation amongst themselves, democratize their nation states. Well, that is a question that brought about Diem. Because the answer we gave to this question, and therefore came together, was negative. That this is not going to happen, folks, if the European Union, despite its awfulness and horrid, anti-democratic nature, not just a deficit of democracy, an anti-democratic nature, nature that is opposed to democracy, which ensures that the European Union in Brussels and Frankfurt is a democracy-free zone. In spite of that, we believe that's what brought us together, that this disbandment, the disintegration of the European Union is going to create waves of xenophobia that are going to undermine what safeguards there are for civil liberties, for women, for the rights of foreigners. It is going to make the economic crisis worse. We know this from the Soviet Union, from Yugoslavia, that every time transnational systems of joint production are disbanded, the economic cost is unbelievable. We know that if we go back to the nation state, it's not going to be the progressives that are going to rule over them. What is more likely to happen is that those nation states will be dominated by figures like Orban or Le Pen. And those national bourgeoisies are going to become more illiberal, more punitive, and more inefficient while attacking the weak of their nation states. That's what we think. This is why we created the M25. This is why we are determined to fight at two fronts, against the deep establishment, which is causing the crisis that is leading to disintegration and to the rise of the nationalist international, of xenophobia, and the lure of greatness, the idea we better go back to the great nation state, and against the nationalist international that is calling for the disintegration of the European Union. We don't have an easy job. We have to fight at two fronts. But this is our task. And the M25 is determined to follow this through. Joachim Avgerinos, or Joachim Avgerinos, asks a question. Don't I get scared by the idea of a federal Europe? Well, let me tell you what, Joachim. I get scared by the idea of more Europe. I certainly get scared by the idea of more Europe. If by more Europe, we mean more of the same Europe. If we mean more of Mr. Dijsselbloem, more of Mr. Schäuble, more of the Troika, more of a European Central Bank that strangles at birth a progressive government that dares say, hang on, folks, the program you've been imposing on our country has been a dismal failure. This anti-democratic European Union, we do not want more of. Absolutely not. But you ask me the question, am I scared of a federal Europe? Now, what is a federal Europe? Depends on what kind of federation you have, right? The Soviet Union was a federation. We don't want that kind of federation. But we do want a democratic federation. A democratic federation in which, imagine, where a situation where we elected directly the government of Europe, the European Commission, the Eurogroup, the ECOFIN, the European Union Council. Now, you may say that, well, all finance ministers have been elected. The European Union Council consists of presidents and prime ministers have been elected. Yes. But you know, when they go in there, firstly, they do everything behind closed doors, as I have, I think, repeated sufficiently. And when they come home, none of them really support what has been decided. Don't even think that they do know what has been decided. And if things turn out really badly as a result of the things that they decided, they can always blame each other. They can say, oh, you know, the Greek prime minister or the French president or the German chancellor or the German finance minister for that matter can say, well, you know, I tried my best, but, you know, I was one out of 27, out of 19. And the issue here is that you do not have a European Parliament in Europe today. We do not have a European Parliament. That can dismiss the whole lot of them. You can say to the European Union Council, well, you failed. Go. And unless you have a parliament at the federal level, which can dismiss those who make laws, and it's not the parliament in Europe that makes laws, it's the European Union Council. So the parliament that we have in name, in practice, cannot dismiss those who make laws. Now, that is a definition of a dictatorship. It's, well, maybe not a dictatorship, but at least it's a definition of a non-democracy. So a federal democracy in Europe, I wouldn't be scared of. Of course, your question again was more specific on cultural issues. Don't I fear that if we have a proper federation, we're going to lose our Greekness, our culture, our language, or you know, the Hungarians will lose their language and their culture, the French will be Americanized or Britishized or, you know, Germanized. No, I don't. Our cultures are very strong and very powerful. And if anything, a democratic federation, a properly functioning democratic European governance would give more degrees of freedom to nation state, to our people, to develop culture. Imagine if we didn't have this awful crisis here in Greece today. Imagine if Germany was not constantly under the fear that the French and the Italians would take away their surpluses. Imagine if Europe worked, in other words. Would German culture, French culture, Hungarian culture, Portuguese culture, Greek culture suffer? No, I do not believe so. I think they would get stronger. So, yes, of course, it has never happened before that you can have a democratic federation across many different languages that actually works, and I'm not referring to Belgium here. Whether Belgium works or not is another matter. I'll let our Belgian comrades tell us. And next Saturday, we're all going to be in Brussels at the Bazaar. Maybe we can have this discussion. But no, I'm not worried. Now, Yad Goshen from Lebanon asked the question, how can friends of them who are not Europeans in the European Union, or Lebanese, for instance, or Brazilians, I believe we have organizations even in South Korea, DCs, how can... Well, they feel a bit strange being part of a democracy in Europe movement. Well, let me say this to all of you who come from countries outside official Europe. We at DiEM25 are totally against borders. We believe that borders are scars on the face of the earth. Now, you can't be against borders and say to someone, well, you cannot be a member of DiEM because you don't come from Europe. Because what's Europe? If you don't believe in borders, I don't believe in borders. I think that borders are such a bad idea. And anyway, they're meaningless, especially today. And they should be meaningless. If you don't believe in borders, what is the border of Europe? Well, I don't see any borders of Europe. You know, Alexander the Great took Europe all the way to Afghanistan. We have on the coordinating collective Noam Chomsky. He's not European, he lives in Boston. But I can think of few people that we would like to have on our coordinating collective as much as we want to have now. Europe is an idea. And therefore, in Lebanon, in Brazil, in South Korea, and in Boston, there are radical Europeanists who are our comrades and we are working together. In any case, we are internationalists. Europe is just the beginning of us. We want to civilize Europe because Europe is the most precarious part of the world at the moment. My personal view is that it's a sick man or woman, so as not to be sexist, of the global political economy. We need to stabilize it for the sake of the world, of humanity. Ideally, we would love to have a democracy in the Americas movement, a democracy in the Middle East movement, a democracy in Asia movement, a democracy in Africa movement. And then we can all join together in a democracy for the planet movement. But of course, let's not get carried away here. Now, a question that has emerged time and again in your comments, in today's list of questions, but also wherever we meet DiEMers, concerns the future of DiEM. Are we going to go electoral? Are we going to contest elections? Well, let me take it right from the beginning. Oh, by the way, I need to make a short apology. There are many comrades from France, from Italy, from Portugal, who are complaining that this is happening in English. Similarly, from Greece. Sigonometry, yeah? This is a central DiEM broadcast, live event, and I'm very, very much afraid that I don't speak any other language except for Greek. So, your choice is between Greek and English. Judith Mayer, our volunteer coordinator, would suggest that we all learn Esperanto and we communicate in Esperanto. It's a possibility. But if we vote that we'll all learn Esperanto over a period of a month, then I will do so myself. So let me go back to the question about our going electoral as DiEM25. I'll take it from the top. When we created DiEM25, when we founded DiEM25, it was February 2016, if you remember, at the Volksbühne Theater in Berlin. Consistently, we answered this question by saying that those of us who are putting DiEM25 together really do not like contesting elections. We are not traditional politicians. We're not politicians at all, we're political activists. We would much rather not have to contest any elections. Our task is to bring European Democrats across national borders and political party divisions together in order to stop this constant slide of Europe into a postmodern abyss, a regressive abyss, an abyss of hopelessness and xenophobia and crisis. Our first task, that's the one we proclaimed to Agenda, was to answer the question, what needs to be done in Europe? What needs to be done tomorrow morning, in 6 months, in 2 years, by 2025, last DiEM25. And we worked very hard for more than a year. We've come up with a number of policy papers. I'm particularly proud of the European New Deal policy paper. It is, as far as I'm concerned, correct me if I'm wrong, read other ones, read the equivalent papers by the Greens, by Social Democrats, and so on. I think it's by far the most coherent, substantial policy agenda for Europe, because it tackles all the issues. It's not about the Eurozone, it's not about the EU even, it's about every country in the European Union and ways we can have a pan-European economic and social policy agenda that heals this continent and brings us together in a progressive way. And this is what we worked on. We presented this on the 25th of March, last March, in Rome. And after presenting it, or during the presentations of the European New Deal, we said, okay, now we think we know what needs to be done in Europe. Now the question is, how do we do it? And then, of course, the question appears on the horizon. Are we going to contest elections? Because let's face it, political parties, existing political parties, some of which are very close to us, emotionally, ideologically, personally, politically, we'll only take you seriously, really take you seriously, if you can help them win votes. Now, we have a serious problem here in Europe, I believe, with our friends, with our political friends. One is that the existing pan-European political groupings are so divided between them and within them. If you look at the European Party of the Left, you know, there's Mélenchon, there is Tsipras. Tsipras signed on the Memorandum of Understanding dotted line, and now his government is proclaiming that doing as the Troika demands of the Greek government is the way out of the crisis. And then you have Mélenchon, who's proclaiming Plan B exit strategy from the monetary union, at least. Now, how can these be coherent? How can we go with them if they if they're not coherent amongst themselves? So, the same thing we find within progressive parties, a great deal of division amongst themselves. And at DiEM, we are really not interested in playing these political games of having some kind of confluence with all these political actors that disagree with one another, that can certainly not agree with our principles. We didn't get into this game in order to start compromising even before we established ourselves politically. Now, as you know, there is an ongoing discussion within DiEM. It will culminate sometime in October, early October, in one or two votes, internal votes, where you will all get an opportunity to vote on how we go about it. It is my view that this European New Deal is too good to waste. I believe that European peoples around here, everywhere, from Britain, independent of whether Britain gets in and out or gets out of the EU, as it, I'm sure it will or not, or countries like Serbia that are not in the EU, Switzerland that are not in the EU, other countries that are in the EU but not in the Eurozone, like Denmark, Sweden, and of course the Eurozone member states. We have this European New Deal policy agenda that deserves to be explained properly to the peoples of Europe all over the European continent in such a way that they also have an opportunity to vote for it, to support it electorally. Exactly how we're going to do this is a question that we're going to decide in the next month or so. But allow me to share with you my view. My view is that DiEM should not transform itself. I'm not talking personally. I'm not representing DiEM. I'm not representing the coordinating collective. This is Yanni speaking. My views are just as important as anybody else's, or as unimportant as anybody else's. But this is the argument I'm going to be carrying in this debate. I don't believe that DiEM25 should transform itself into a political party. I think that DiEM25 should create a transnational political party in the same way we create all sorts of other instruments like committees and thematic groups that I'm going to enter into discussing in a minute. I think we should register DiEM25 affiliated parties, but in a way that we do not create yet another party. I mean, we're all sick and tired of political parties. There must be a completely different kind of approach to electoral contest. The general idea that that is percolating in my head these days is that it would be fantastic if DiEM25, all of us, generated an electoral wing in Greece, in other countries. Whether we will run in elections or not depends on whether we find other political actors that can take our European New Deal agenda and other progressive parts of our progressive agenda for Europe, like the European Union Constitutional Assembly process, which is absolutely essential and intertwined with the European New Deal. And if we do, that would be fantastic. Who wants to contest elections? You can avoid it. At least not those of us who really don't want to do it, and we disdain having political office. We will only do it if we must, we can't escape it. And imagine that all of us make those decisions, but the electoral wing in Britain, in Greece, in Germany, whatever, decide whether they want to support other political actors, whether they want to enter into coalitions with other political actors, or whether there is absolutely nothing that is essential to run on their own. But these decisions are made by DiEM25, the movement, and members of DiEM25 are not obliged even to belong to the electoral wing in their own countries. You may be a member of the Labour Party and choose to stay in the Labour Party. we must break down this old-fashioned idea that the party owns us, and we are citizens of the party or subjects of the party, of any party. This is why I don't believe in a party. If we create DiEM25 affiliated parties, it should be because they're instruments for pushing forward our progressive agenda. But this is all up for grabs. It's all a subject of discussions between us. But we should not be afraid to contest elections. We should not want it. It would be terrible if we wanted to. But at the same time, it would be equally terrible to be scared of it. On internal democracy. Look, we've always said that democracy begins at home. We really do not want to preach democracy and democratizing Europe when our own organization is suffering a democratic deficit. But of course, what does democracy mean? It's something that we create, like we create the rest of our existence, through struggle, through debate, through improvement, through evolution, through even clashes between us. So let's keep the debate happening amongst ourselves about how DiEM should evolve within itself. You see, I'm very proud of the fact that DiEM has already demonstrated to Europeans how the pan-European demos can be formed. You know, from their own experiences in DiEM25, that when we had the Italian referendum, when it was last year, we all voted as to what position DiEM25 should take, whether we were Italians or not. Poles, Latvians, Greeks, Brits voted for the Italian referendum, what DiEM's position should be. Isn't that fantastic? This is the first time that this has ever happened in any political organization. We are all DiEMers, and we all decide on what our policy will be in Spain, Portugal, in France. This is what we'll carry on doing. Even if we form political parties in Spain, France, Portugal, Greece, we'll all decide together as DiEMers what our political agendas should be. This is radical Europeanism in action. This is how we're creating, through a democratic process that involves all of us Europeans, a pan-European demos, firstly within DiEM25, before we take it outside DiEM25. On the question of internal democracy, but also other matters that concern members, let me say that at the level of the coordinating collective, we spent most of the summer debating amongst ourselves how we should create and formalize thematic groups. A proposal is going to come from the CC to all of you. It is important that those DiEMers who want to form a spontaneous collective, spontaneous thematic collective, to discuss matters of internal democracy, matters concerning agricultural policy, whatever theme you want to discuss, you have a capacity to do it, while at the same time belonging to EDC, if you want to belong to EDC. As I said, this is all work in progress. How the national committees of DiEM25 evolve, how their political work relates to that of the political work of DSCs, of the thematic groups, of the CC, of the validating council. These are matters we need to discuss as we are moving towards a phase in which the European New Deal and our European Union Constitution Assembly process are introduced in the public domain and introduced in such a way as to be giving Europeans an opportunity to vote for them at the ballot box. So as we are becoming more relevant in the political electoral process throughout Europe, we must develop our own organizing principles and our own organization in a way that reflects our democratic credentials and aspirations. These are my answers to Milos Vukovic, to Adam Newby, Bratislav Rakovic, and Arde Farida. A potpourri of their questions was what I just tried to respond to. Now, let me say a few words, if I may, about the European New Deal. I did mention a few things before. It's very important to clarify the purpose of the European New Deal. Its purpose is to stabilize Europe in order to make possible a discussion of what it is necessary in order to move in the direction of a democratized European Union. So we have policies that, in a sense, do two basic things. One is to tackle involuntary unemployment throughout the European Union, and the other one is to tackle involuntary migration within the European Union. Because these two scourges, involuntary unemployment and involuntary migration, are what blows wind into the sails of xenophobia, racism, and the nationalist international. It is what makes our peoples lose hope. It is the reason why some of you have been asking me questions, remember at the beginning, such as, is there light at the end of the tunnel? Is there a future for our children? Is it possible to bring about a coalition of progressives, of working class people across Europe, whether they're Greeks, Germans, Latvians, Lithuanians, or Brits? These two sketches. So we have, if you read our European New Deal, and I invite you to do so, it's on our website, you'll see that we have programs for funding Europe's innovators, those who will create the new green technologies that will take Europe into the future. And we have policies for funding the maintainers, those who maintain existing communities. Because without them, communities are distraught, they're destroyed, people leave, they go from the village or town to the city, they move to Germany, they move to Britain. There's a lot of discontent because they don't want to leave. They are not Odysseus. They are not enjoying the journey. They're leaving not because the food is better in London. They're leaving because they can't make ends meet in Romania. So it is essential that we deal with this. So we have programs for funding both the innovators, such as our proposal for a link up between investment banks like the European Investment Bank and central banks through the quantitative easing program. I'm not going to go into technicalities now. We have, we propose an inheritance tax. We propose a universal basic dividend that is going to be funded from a percentage of the dividends that go into a percentage of the shares that are held by what we call the European Equity Depository. Intellectual property rights help fund the European basic dividend. And then we have a program for the maintainers, which consists of three main ideas. Firstly, fighting poverty, which includes food deprivation, energy deprivation, access to education, and access to health. Secondly, social housing. And thirdly, the community work which is necessary for, say, older people to be kept in their homes, for communities to maintain a capacity to reproduce themselves, even when the local factory has closed down. How do we fund this? We have, if you read the European New Deal, we have, the answer we give to this is through a program that involves, on the one hand, an inheritance tax, which is pan-European. On the other hand, our public digital payment system that will give degrees of freedom to every country in the European Union to produce euro-denominated or other kinds of the of currency-denominated grants that you are used to fund within a certain country those communities. It's a very comprehensive document. This is why we're so keen that the European New Deal is understood by us. It is taken to every nook and cranny in Europe, and in the end, it is given the possibility of being tested at the ballot box. Allow me now to answer a couple of questions, one on France and one on Britain. I was asked the question about, let me see, who was it that asked this of me? There was a question about Emmanuel Macron. Was I surprised by his austerian turn, the fact that he adopted austerity? No. This is why we did not support Emmanuel in the first round of the French presidential election. because it was clear what he was trying to do. He was trying to come to a Faustian bargain between himself and Angela Merkel. He had the view that if he offers Merkel austerity in France and the Germanized labor market, introducing labor market reforms that remove protection from French workers, that she would then grant him in return the Federation Light, a small federation, tiny federation that he thought could be extracted from Angela Merkel. I don't believe that Macron believes in austerity. This is my personal view. I believe that he thinks that it is important to show the German government that France is prepared to play by the rules that are so beloved of Berlin, and in exchange get a Federation Light. I don't believe he's going to get a Federation Light. Already Schäuble, Schulz even, and Merkel have rejected this. They are asking him to accept something different, the European Monetary Fund, which is effectively an extension of the bailout fund from which Greece has been borrowing money, Portugal, Spain, Cyprus, Ireland, which effectively means the Troika in Paris, because the only way you can borrow money, or that France could borrow money from, or use some of the funding of the European Stability Mechanism, this new European Monetary Fund, which is Schäuble's idea mainly, for investment purposes and other purposes that Macron wants in France, is by submitting the French national budget to the Troika process, which is what Schäuble always wanted. This was such a bad idea by Emmanuel Macron. I have to give him, though, small credit, because on yesterday he came up with an idea that suits the Dim 25 very well. And this is the idea that a number of MPs, from between 50 and 70, in the European Parliament, should be elected on the basis of a pan-European ticket. As you know, presently, all European members of Parliament are elected by nation states. It would be very good if we had a pan-European list. Dim would, I think, appreciate that a lot. Now, of course, this is a tiny token by Emmanuel Macron in comparison to the enormity of the damage he's going to do to French society by means of his labor legislation, especially the second phase that's coming in October, where he's going to try to reform the unemployment benefit scheme. That is going to be terrible, terrible turn of events. Very soon, I cannot see Emmanuel Macron remaining a credible figure amongst progressives in France, and that is when Mrs. Merkel is going to treat him with contempt. Then there was a question about Brexit and the possibility of a second referendum to reverse Brexit. Let me say that my position on this, again speaking personally, but also as DiEM, because we went through a process of voting for a Brexit position, my position has been very clear. We fought against Brexit. We fought for a radical Remain in the EU, against this EU, was a slogan that we had in Britain. The people of Britain did not listen to us for their own reasons. One of the excellent arguments that was used against me was, yeah, that's very nice. I mean, we would love it if somebody like you guys from DiEM25 were running Britain, then we would vote for in this EU, against this EU, because somebody in 10 Downing Street, Prime Minister's residence in Britain, would oppose this EU. But if we voted to stay in, to remain, we would simply have David Cameron and George Osborne doing exactly the same things as before. And that would be proclaimed as a great victory for the establishment. Nevertheless, we at DiEM25 opposed Brexit. But as Democrats, we have to respect it. The question is, what kind of Brexit? And the view of DiEM25 has always been that Brexit cannot happen overnight. The people of Britain did not vote for any particular kind of Brexit. So, let's have an interim period of something like 7 years, during which Britain is out, it assumes a position similar to Norway, minimal changes, Britain is out, so as to give the British Parliament an opportunity to debate in the fullness of time and without a ticking clock and a gun on its head, what kind of arrangements it wants for the United Kingdom and the EU. Now, this seems to be now the policy of Jeremy Corbyn. We've had some success in convincing Jeremy Corbyn to adopt it. It is also accepted by a large part of the Conservative Party, even. But my personal view, allow me to say again what my personal view is, TM25's position is, again, work in progress on this matter. My personal view is that it's a major mistake to aim for a long transition period if we think that the EU will stay as is and the UK will stay as is. I do not believe that the European Union can stay as is and survive. It is at an advanced stage of disintegration anyway. And I do not believe that the United Kingdom can stay as it is. It is an unsustainable political economy. So Jeremy Corbyn and all our comrades, and Caroline Lucas and the good people, the Scottish National Party and Plaid Cymru, progressives in the United Kingdom, must push Britain towards a transformation along progressive lines, along the lines of the European Union. And we on the continent must do the same thing with the European Union. And if we succeed, then I would like a second referendum, but not to cancel Brexit. Brexit should happen. We should respect it. No, the second referendum should be for a progressive United Kingdom to re-enter a progressive, democratized European Union. Now, let me now briefly turn to some criticisms towards me. Andreas Haralambos asks me a question. I'm sure he asked it angrily. He said, "Do you still hate Tsipras? He doesn't need you." Well, Andrea, let me tell you this. I never hated Tsipras. I don't hate Tsipras. I suffered as a result of watching him being reduced to the state of signing on the dotted line of something that he was constitutionally opposed to signing. But at the very same time, Andrea, I had a duty to 142,000 people who voted for me in Athens B, in my constituency. The duty was to tell them what happened. Now, I know that you've read a lot of things about what my book says, but I bet you haven't read my book. In the same way that you should not trust the systemic media to get your information about what Tsipras thinks or does, that you should have your own view about it, I would advise you to either not comment on what I say or read my book. And the reason is that if you do, you'll find that there's nothing but a comradely attitude towards all my comments. I'm critical of mistakes that I saw. Of course, I may be wrong and I may be right. But nowhere will you see any vilification. You see, as a left-winger, who is nevertheless absolutely, utterly aware of the sorry history of the left, not just in Greece, but everywhere. And we spent the 20th century chasing each other, hounding each other, killing each other, putting comrades in a gulag. This tendency of the left towards sectarianism and towards hating each other and denouncing each other is not one that you would ever hear me repeat. I have never used any epithets by which to characterize Alexis or Euclid or any of my colleagues. I will criticize what they do, but that's my job. And it's their job to criticize me. And let's move on from there. Whether he needs me or not, it's neither here nor there. We are all insignificant little worms slithering across the face of the earth. What really matters is what the people of Greece need, what the people of Britain need, what the people of France need. And allow me to say that the one thing they do not need is this memorandum of understanding in Greece, the Troika in Athens, because that is the first step for the Troika to go everywhere, in Paris in particular. There was another question. There was a funny question by Rosita Alinsk. What batteries do I use to find the energy to keep going? Well, Rosita, I have no idea. But all I can tell you is that, you know, politics is fun. Because You know, I'm an atheist. I do not believe in a second life or in the afterlife. This is the only life I have, as far as I'm concerned. And the one thing in life I never wanted to allow to happen is for other people to make decisions for me without me even knowing it or knowing what their motives are. And, you know, doing what I'm doing at this very moment, looking at your questions, answering them, being a political animal, keeps me alive. It makes me want to wake up in the morning and do stuff. So that, I think that's where the batteries are. The batteries come from the polis, the idea of the city in which we all reflect into each other's eyes and become who we are, humans. There have been questions about universal basic income versus universal basic dividend. Look, you can read all about that. I don't need to bother you with this so much. There is another disparaging, not just against me, by, I think it was, yes, Nikos Karidis, who wrote, you can see it in the chat column, that, you know, the left is completely wrong about everything, mumbo-jumbo economics. And I quote, the country is no different, is not any different than any family unit. That you have a certain income and you then have to make sure that you spend within your means, otherwise you're in trouble and you're bankrupt and everything else is left in mum and job. Well, allow me to tell you, Nikos, that this is precisely wrong. Precisely wrong. I'm not telling you that there are no limits to how much debt the government can have. No. But to say that the country is no different to family is to get it entirely the wrong way around. Some of you may have heard me say this before, I've said this on British television a number of times, I'll say it again. The beauty of being an individual or a firm or a household is the independence between our income and our expenditure. So if tonight you and I do not go out to a restaurant, we will have saved money. Our income is not going to be affected. So whatever we have in our wallet or our bank account. Yeah? It's independent of whether we go to a restaurant or not. But for a country, the total expenditure equals the total income. So when you've got a diminution of total income and total expenditure, since they are the same thing, a recession in other words, and suddenly the private sector, families, companies, start saving because their income is being reduced. If the government steps in and does austerity, then the sum of private and public expenditure starts coming down. What's the sum of private and public expenditure? National income. So the state will make the recession worse. And then you enter into this downward spiral that we're experiencing this. Now, this is not a manifesto for, you know, printing money or spending as if there's no tomorrow from the position of government. Absolutely not. When I was in the Ministry of Finance, I was advocating primary surpluses for this. That the Greek state should have a commitment to a primary surplus of 1-1.5% of national income. What I was arguing against was having large primary surpluses in a time of recession. Okay? It's what John Maynard Keynes referred to as the fallacy of composition. And if you think that John Maynard Keynes' economics is mumbo jumbo, okay, you may very well say so, but I couldn't possibly comment. Let me take a few more questions here at random. Somebody asked, who was that somebody? Dirk Verstenreuten. I believe. So, well, is it better to create, to think of that DiEM as a confluence, an organization which will bring together all pro-European Union organizations? The answer is no, Dirk, no. Because there are many pro-European organizations that do not understand what is a major malady of the European Union. Who want more Europe, is what I was saying before. More of the same Europe. We do not want more of the same Europe. This is why we're going to, of course, talk to everyone. but we're not going to become simply an agglomeration of everybody who says more Europe. Let me see. Gabriel Morales asked the question. Is automation and e-government going to make bankers and politicians obsolete? Not on your mailing. Keep dreaming. I wish. What automation and the internet and the 3D printer is doing is eradicating capitalism. In the long term, I don't know how long that term would be, maybe in 5 years, maybe in 50 years. I don't see capitalism being viable, given the technological innovations. And the reason I'm saying that is because think about, take any large corporation. Why does Volkswagen exist? Why does General Motors or General Electric exist? It exists because you have economies of scale. You have factories that are owned by a company which also has, through vertical integration, the design component, the design department, marketing department, all these departments. And they start designing a car, and then they produce the car, and then they have dealerships, and they sell the car, for instance. Well, with artificial intelligence, with computer-aided design, with 3D printing, very soon, all the production is going to happen at huge utilities constituting gigantic 3D printers that will make anything from paper clips to spaceships. And then, of course, all the value will be in the designing of it. But then why do you need a vertically integrated corporation? I do not see the corporation as having a future. The corporations are producing, in other words, the technologies that will make them obsolete. And this is a purely Marxist dialectic, if you want. But that is not going to eradicate bankers and politicians. Not on its own. What you need to throw into the mix of technological innovation in order to get to the point where banking and the banker's exorbitant power is restrained is democracy. Because unless we democratize the economic process through something like the universal basic dividend that DiEM25 is putting forward, unless we democratize that, the bankers will always retain control of financial flows, and the 0.001% are going to control a huge quantity of the income generated by the robots, and that will create a major, major crisis because the majority will not have the means by which to purchase what the robots produce, and the robots will not have any interest in purchasing what they produce. We're coming to a close slowly. Let's talk a little bit about Greece, not about Greece, but me. A couple of personal questions. One is by Martha Duma. Iduma. She's asking me, why do I honor Greek journalists? Why do I go to television shows? I don't do this very often, but nevertheless, I do. When they are so rabid, so rude, so clearly biased, they don't let me speak, they keep shouting abuse at me instead of asking questions. But look, it's not pleasant, Martha. It really isn't. But on the other hand, I feel it's my duty to expose them. Because when I appear on their show and viewers watch them stop me from answering the questions that they put to me and putting words in my mouth, this reinforces the sense of outrage in the good people of Greece who are no longer persuaded by the media. This is the beauty about the depth of the crisis in which we find ourselves. We are in something like the Soviet Union in the 1980s, early 1980s. The party line was given, the television channels were saying the same thing, so did the newspapers, and no one believed them. This is where we are now. It's important to expose them. So this is why I do. There was another question by Ben Hall, which is one that I wanted to make. He says, well, is DiEM25 politically and ideologically suspect? Why do you have so many Putin, Vladimir Putin apologists in your midst? And even goes on to describe Julian Assange as a fugitive from Swedish rape charges. Ben, well, firstly, let me address your point that we, in our videos, we show, we use some footage from RT, Russia Today. This happened because it's the only footage that we find when we do. Are we putting up Putin apologists? Well, let me tell you a story. When I first got my position as professor at the University of Athens in the early 2000s, I was the only professor on the faculty board of the Department of the Faculty of Economics that voted against the granting of a doctorate to Vladimir Putin. And my explanation in there was that he's a war criminal as a result of his deeds in Chechnya. He destroyed, he flattened a whole country just in order to become president or prime minister and then president of Russia. So you cannot really call me, at least me, a Putin apologist. Yeah, I still have this view about Vladimir Putin. Now, let's now go to Julian Assange. Julian Assange is a remarkable human being. He has taken a gigantic personal toll in order to confront the powers that be everywhere. He could be something like the CEO of Google. He has the technical expertise to be that, and he chose to be risking his life and to be incarcerated. How? By creating the anti-Big Brother WikiLeaks technology that allows you and me to learn about the abuse of power by the powers that be. We owe him a debt of gratitude. Now, do we agree with everything on with, you know, with Julian? We'll ask him and he'll tell you that we often have major, major political clashes. So for instance, even though he is a member of the advisory panel of Team 25, just before the Brexit referendum, he came out in favor of Brexit. And we had a major fight on the phone about that. But this is what good Democrats and friends do. Now, a fugitive from Swedish rape charges? Are you serious? Don't you read the news? Firstly, there have never been any rape charges. He had never been charged. Had he been charged, I would have been of the view that he would have to go and answer for his, you know, answer the charges in court. He was never charged. The extradition order was tabled so that they would talk to him. And he said, well, I'll talk to you any time you want, but, and I'll even come to Sweden as long as you do not extradite me from the United States, where the whole establishment were threatening either to kill him or to make sure that he disappears in the Supermax jail system of the United States of America. For what? For making sure that you and I know about the abuses of the American army in Iraq, the abuses of the surveillance corporate and state machinery, and so on and so forth. And when, in the end, the Swedish prosecutor agreed last fall to go to the Ecuadorian embassy in London to interview in order to find out if she wanted to lay charges, then in the end, a few months later, she came out with a verdict that she does not want to lay charges. Now, Democrats and people who believe in the rule of law also believe in something called the presumption of innocence. Are you telling me that you condemn somebody who has not even been charged for a crime that he hasn't even been charged with? Look, this is ludicrous. It is really very simple. Julian Assange is being persecuted as a whistleblower. Okay? Now, he can infuriate you because he supports Brexit. He can infuriate you about A, B, or C. I can infuriate you about A, B, or C. But to fall in the trap of those who are persecuting whistleblowers who are on our side, on the side of transparency and democracy, is a major error, allow me to say. Let me finish off with, because the time has lapsed. By returning to the question of, is there light at the end of the tunnel? And where should we find the energy to be hopeful when all the evidence is pointing to unpleasant developments. Well, if you had told me in 2011 that in 2015 the Greek Spring would take place, if you had told most of our comrades in Britain that Jeremy Corbyn would have done so magnificently in the last general election, and he would have secured the largest share of the vote since 1945 for the Labour Party, nobody would have believed. I wouldn't have believed you. Nobody would have believed you. We can do it. What we must decide, just decide as a, you know, the power of will, is that within us there lays an invincible spring like the Athens spring. And when it comes to taking risks in order to go forward, I'm just going to finish off with something that Anais Nin wrote once. And the day came when the risk it took to remain tight inside the bud was more painful than the risk it took it to blossom. Carpe diem.